Thank you again, everybody. Committed to hold, and so now we call to order. Any disclosure of pecuniary interest in the nature thereof. Seeing none, we'll move right on to delegations. And we have Linda Kay and Heather Norris from Northumberland Way regarding new investment strategies and fundraising processes. Would you like to come up, please? And thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Sanderson and members of council. I'm Linda Kay, I'm the CEO of the United Way, and we're very pleased to be here tonight. We're very pleased to recognize the staff and the municipality of Port Hope for their support of the United Way campaign when we wrapped up our campaign a couple of weeks ago. This evening, I'm going to have our Director of Community Impact, Heather Norris, give you an overview of our journey to impact. So I'm going to turn things over to Heather.
Thank you very much, and good evening. So I'm going to talk a little bit about who we are, given we're such a prominent and recognized brand, and then we'll share our recent journey to community impact with you. So did you know that there are over 100 United Ways across Canada, and United Ways engaged in more than 40 countries and territories worldwide? Each one is an autonomous nonprofit organization governed by a volunteer-led board of directors. Each United Way raises money and allocates funds locally to support its community. Northumberland United Way is the largest non-government funder of health and social services in Northumberland County. And Northumberland United Way is the largest privately funded nonprofit in the world. Northumberland United Way is approaching its 50th anniversary, which is an amazing milestone and will be one soon worth celebrating. Every dollar invested directly in Northumberland United Way stays in Northumberland County. I'm sure some may be wondering if this truly is the case, so I'll clarify. We do pay membership dues to United Way Canada, and we do accept designations to other organizations, those not funded by our United Way. Most often these are through payroll deductions or stock donations, and they do include gifts to organizations outside Northumberland County. It's a donor's right to select a charity of choice, and we help facilitate this donation. We appreciate that donors make a personal choice in terms of directing their philanthropic dollars, but we particularly love dollars designated to Northumberland United Way, which all stays in Northumberland County. 1 in 4 lives are annually impacted through Northumberland United Way funded services, which is well over 20,000 a year. Most people are aware that we historically funded member agencies, which are those listed here as our community partners. But we do much more. We also facilitate programs and partnerships. For example, our partnership with Habitat for Humanity is unique in that United Way helped initiate a fund for low-income homeowners to apply for a 0% interest-free loan for home repairs. Habitat volunteers can even assist with the repairs to reduce costs even more for the homeowner. This loan gets paid back, so it's a revolving fund for other home repairs. We are on a journey, and as you can see, we've been on this journey for well over 10 years. 2004 to 2006, with Ontario Trillium Foundation funding, we completed stakeholder conversations to better understand social issues. We were among 17 United Ways to do this. Then Northumberland United Way, along with Oxford, Leeds and Grenville, and Sault Ste. Marie, received Trillium Foundation funding to undertake an Action for Community Change project. Here's where the rubber really hit the road. In 2013, we used the Harwood model, which centered on turning outward, to guide us through community conversations. Over 25 community conversations took place with residents across Northumberland County. During these conversations, residents shared their aspirations, hopes, and the challenges they face. To build on this public knowledge, a panel of local experts were brought together in the fall of 2014 to advise United Way on existing initiatives in the community and to provide recommendations regarding which strategies could achieve the greatest impact. Based on the consolidation of both public and expert knowledge, United Way established a new investment framework to guide our community impact investments. We are now communicating this journey as our funding process has changed. summary, we uncovered common issues faced in Northumberland, such as access to information, transportation, employment and skills training, to name just a few. We combined this public knowledge with over 30 expert community stakeholders, such as Northumberland County, the Health Unit, and the School Board. Our local member agencies were also involved and have been informed throughout this process that was guided by local volunteers. Over 3,000 volunteer hours contributed to this work. All of this supported the creation of a new investment framework. I should also mention that this is happening across the country. It's not unique to our United Way. And it's worth noting that Northumberland United Way received a National President's Award for Innovation from United Way Canada for this work. We adopted the three National United Way focus areas: promoting all that kids can be, building strong communities, and moving from poverty to possibility. Within these focus areas are seven investment strategies focused on recreation opportunities, mental health prevention and early intervention, access to information and support services, employment, basic necessities, and housing. Moving forward, as organizations apply to Northumberland United Way for funding, they will need to identify that they clearly align with one of our investment strategies. In addition to this, they will be required to measure and report outcomes and impact. We haven't included the measurable outcomes here. However, each investment strategy has 2 to 4 desired strategy outcomes to be measured and reported. By identifying, measuring, and reporting on these common outcomes, Northumberland United Way can accurately measure the impact of its funded investments and report this to our donors and our community. Our outcomes measurement requirements have also built capacity and strengthened our community partners. By providing training and assistance on logic models, outcome measurement, and reporting, they are better equipped to adjust their programs and services based on this data. It also helps them apply to other funding opportunities as outcomes measurement is becoming best practice. I know this is a lot of information to process, so if you're left wondering what has really changed, I'll break some of it down. Our funding model before was more a traditional model. It's now a community impact model. Our historically funded member agencies were invited to apply for funding. Eligible nonprofits will be welcome in the future. We had one annual application process, and we're moving towards a two-phase process. Organizations will submit an expression of interest, and successful applicants will be invited to submit a full application. The strategy for funding was based on the needs of the member agencies, and will now focus on United Way investment strategies that address current needs and create local impact. A community review process, which is the process of recruiting community volunteers to assist United Way in reviewing funding applications and the allocation of funds to community partners. This has been and will continue to be the application review process that is bias-free, transparent, and consistent. So this means that we are in a funding transition process with our movement towards funding desired investment strategies, defined investment strategies, sorry. We will soon be welcoming new community partnerships, and we are focused on creating and reporting impact. Why is change necessary? Because as time marches on, the needs, demographics, and the social pressures in Northumberland County have evolved. Programs and services must serve today's needs, and this isn't to say that anything's wrong with how we've been working to date. Indeed, we're quite proud of our outstanding record over the years, but rather we believe we can do even better. With finite resources, everyone wants to make the greatest impact with each and every dollar. Our new community impact investment model will allow us to do just that. We are a funder of health and social services that support the residents of Northumberland County. We are a researcher, as evidenced in our community conversations, and we continue to engage research opportunities. Given we have no local university or college campus, we are somewhat research poor in terms of conducting research and accessing and storing local data. We are an educator in terms of supporting ease of access to current information. Our support and promotion of 211 is one example. 211 is an award-winning telephone helpline that provides a gateway to community, social, health, and government services. It's free, confidential, accessible 24/7 with a live answer in over 150 languages. We have recently received material in Arabic to accommodate the Syrian refugees arriving. We also support a monthly Warkworth community lunch, which is an initiative that evolved out of our community conversations. Having identified a need in Warkworth to assist with addressing food security, rural isolation, and ensuring individuals are connected to programs and service supports, at each monthly lunch, we schedule a guest or community service provider to give a brief and informal update on services available in the area. It could be Habitat talking about the Renew It program, or the Health Center promoting the Ontario Electricity Support Program for low-income households. We are also a partner, and we value the partnerships that mobilize community resources. We are confident that the results of our journey to community impact will promote stability in areas of highest need, hereby making a real difference in the lives of people in our community. Change is necessary, and it's energizing. This is an exciting time for Northumberland United Way, our partners, and our community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions from council? Deputy Mayor?
I promise that I have a question for you. Just a couple things. Slide number 3, our support is far-reaching. You list a number of community partners. What's the criteria for becoming a community partner in comparison with all the other organizations that are listed under community impact grants and that? How do you select that, or how do they join?
Historically, we had member agencies, and this is what we're talking about moving away from. A lot of the partnerships there we've had for many, many, many years. Some of the other organizations listed there, for say like Greenwood, would have applied to us for funding through our granting programs, but before they were volunteer-based organizations providing services locally in our community. Okay.
And if you could turn to slide number 1, it's a question, it's of personal interest more than anything else, the very first one, that one there, it says Heather Norris, MPNL. Can you tell me what that means?
I sure can.
I'm a recent graduate, master's graduate from Carleton University in a first program of its kind in Canada called Master of Philanthropy and Nonprofit Leadership. So I was very lucky and thrilled to be accepted into the first cohort of the program. So I completed it, I was working full time and I completed it over 2 years in part-time studies and I finished in 2015.
Congratulations, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Can I move in a second to receive this information? Councilor Hickey, Deputy Mayor Burns, all those in favor? Thank you very much for a great presentation and congratulations on the evolutionary work you're doing.
Thank you.
I'd like to call on Neil Pemberton, Jack River Sports Complex Revitalization Working Group, regarding update and progress the status of the Jack River Sports Complex Revitalization Project. Thanks, Neil.
Good evening, Mayor Sanderson, members of council, and the public. My name is Neil Pemberton, and I am the chair of the Jack River Revitalization Committee Working Group. I'm pleased to stand before you tonight to advise Council that the Jack River Sports Revitalization Project is now completed. We still have a few minor invoices to sort through as well as follow up on deficiencies. However, the bulk of the work has been completed. I would also like to take this opportunity to let council know that the project was completed within budget and with approximately $200,000 remaining in fundraising monies. The monies remaining in fundraising will be used to complete aspects of the project that we were not able to complete due to budget restraints at the time of tendering. As previously reported to council, the main focus will be to renovate the existing pro shop, staff office, referees room, and to construct a new arena change room suitable for use of our female now hockey players or male figure skaters. It's another change room and a new referees room. We will also take this includes the new lobby flooring. We would like to in the existing arena. We are going to endeavor to put new flooring in there to blend the new building with the old building to make it transition a little bit better, which will include new flooring, a new pro shop, improvements to the lower warm room viewing area, and exterior siding along the sub side to the end of the building, so it would blend in with our new siding. And hopefully we'd like to put a electronic, I'm not sure the dimension, 10 by 12 or activity sign out on the front of the building and we see that as a way of communicating with whatever group would like to put their information on it. So we will, once the Panthers are hopefully successful in their playoff run this year, I think maybe tomorrow, or there's a walkthrough, the tendering process is on the way. So once they're done, we would hope to get back into the building and do this work prior to the target date would be hockey season for upcoming in September. I'd also like to talk a little bit about, as evident of a staff report, usage of the facility since it has been reopened in September has far exceeded the staff's and the volunteers anticipated. Lessons have increased by just over 40%. Drop-in programs are up by 25%. AquaFit, AquaEasy has increased by 52%. The community room, which is certainly near and dear to a lot of people's hearts, has proven to be a huge success, with the multiple rooms being used for fitness, yoga, tai chi, music lessons, birthday parties, corporate functions, and you tell me the list can go on. We've had a couple times where we've had people up top and down below at the same time, so very positive. Staff are predicting the usage of this room to far exceed their expectations. Moving the canteen to a centralized location is also proving to be very successful. At this point, we haven't gone quite a year, and the increase of $9,000 in revenues and enhanced menus, which include more healthier food choices, have been added, and it's been received very positively. A lot of our senior ladies that come to AquaFit in the mornings are now staying around in the lobby, having their coffee or having a muffin or having a banana, and just talking after their session. So whether it's Tim Hortons or the community center, it's working. So up until now. Of greater significance is the fact that that this community facility is now fully accessible. For many years, staff and years you struggled with the confines of the old facility, and now the struggles are over. The family accessible change room is being very well received, and the accessibility area is making life so much easier for those with disabilities who wish to participate in recreational swimming or viewing of hockey games. Also, our new para-swim program, a partnership with NORAC, has now 9 participants, which didn't mean much to me, but when they tell me, it's just fabulous. 9's a great number. So that's really positive. The arena is now also accessible, and the new viewing area in the stands is being used on a regular basis and and can be added more. It's designed that if need be, it can be expanded. There are many people to thank, and most of it covered off in the opening ceremonies back in September, October, but I truly like to thank council and the previous council for their support and their vision to see this facility brought into the 21st century. I would also like to thank members of the start with the fundraising group, which included Carla Andrews, Zach Andrews, Liz Stewart, Trudy Stacy, and they went out and fundraised so we could put the extras back into the facility. So thank you very much, people. And they were led through the exercise by staff members Leslie Roseblade and Julia Snook. So, wonderful job. Also, I'd like to thank on the working group, Joy Allo, Deputy Mayor Burns started with the project, and now we have Councillor Lees with the project. Jim McCormick, our Director of Parks, Recreation, and Culture. Leslie Wright, Roseblade. I'd also would like at this time too to thank our previous director, Karen Sharp, for getting the ball rolling from day one, who is now retired. So I'd also like to thank David Baxter and his finance department here at the town hall. Without them, you know, some of the areas that we had to work through financially, his leadership and his knowledge was invaluable. So it was really, really good to have him on board. This group of people has worked extremely hard and to keep this project on track and on budget. We certainly had our challenges. We still have some challenges. A little bit going forward with these new areas, but we worked united as a team to resolve all the problems that did arise. And I personally think would strongly recommend to council that this kind of model going forward should be highly considered by you people the way it was done. So it was. You know, not having much experience previously, it was kind of easy to kind of work in it, and everybody kind of felt comfortable. So it had great benefits. The newly revitalized facility is in a position now to serve the community for many years to come. I remember when the facility was first built, before I even had children. And now I have the privilege of taking my grandchildren to this facility, and I hope that we've got it in such a condition now that maybe when their grandparents, they can bring their children to this facility. Thank you, and if anybody's got any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Council? Deputy Mayor?
If I may, in your list of platitudes to people who were involved in the process, there was one name missing, and that was yours. Your leadership, sir, while I served in the committee, was outstanding, and many thanks to you.
Thank you.
Councilor Fletcher?
Thank you. Neil, yes, I'd just like to say from a personal note, thank you. I do use the pool quite a bit, and I've been hearing lots of great comments by people who are in the pool. One small complaint, just that it's getting busy and it's harder to park closer to the facility. But I do have one question for you, and I'm not sure. I've noticed some of the trees were removed in planting the front. The landscaping has not been finished quite yet. And I'm just wondering, because somebody asked me last week, is there a plan to put more trees in the front area, or is the landscaping going to change?
Once we go through the tendering process of the female change room or the additional change room, and that work we're going to get, and probably in the next little while, we anticipate that we're going to have some monies on our estimation so far, approximately probably around $100,000 or $125,000. So. We've looked at another entrance going into the arena. Everybody kind of has a little wish list. Our last meeting, we kind of brainstormed through everything on the table, where everything falls into place. Now, if there's some trees and bushes that we're more willing to make it look beautiful, make it open, make it vibrant, make it look attractive, yes.
Just given our Trees of Distinction awards that we gave out tonight, maybe you know, when our grandkids are there, maybe there could be a tree that could get an award at that time. But I think it does look fantastic. The front is really nice. It's a great entrance, and I'm glad to hear there's going to be a transition over to the arena area as well. That's great. So thank you.
I'd also like to commend you personally. I know how hard you worked and the teamwork that was behind it. I was on council when it was originally proposed and driven forward, and that was the year we all spent the big flood. So this community is up to those kind of challenges, and it's just wonderful to see this sort of upgrade. And I would ask everybody to just to give me a hand and applaud you and your effort and your team. Thank you. And thank you for the update. Could I have a mover to accept this for information? Councilor Lees, second by Councilor Hickey. All those in favor? Thank you very much. Now we'll move on to our third delegation, which is Rick Trumper, Water Operations Manager, and Mark Peacock, Director of Watershed Services, Canada Rescue Region Conservation Authority, regarding Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities initiatives.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. I am here alone tonight. Rick is working on a 6-inch water main break, I understand. So you'll have to put up with me. What I want to do tonight is give you some background on the Great Lakes Cities Initiative. And we'll start with two statements that are provided by the initiative. Mayors of the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiatives are a prominent voice in the efforts to protect and restore the vitality of the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence River, and to improve the quality of life for residents of the region. This is an important initiative because it brings the people of the communities to the table in a different way, probably than they have been before. And I want to show you how that comes about as I go through this presentation. Through an integrated approach to environmental, social, and economic agendas within their communities, US and Canadian mayors of the Cities Initiative are leading a movement that will sustain our freshwater resources long into the future. So I want to start after that, those statements, with a couple of facts about Great Lakes. And here we are with Great Lakes. It's about 100,000 square kilometers of water surface. About 30,000, a little bit over 30,000 are Canadian, and over 60,000 are American. So the Americans have a bit more of it. We are the big players in Lake Ontario. A lot more people on Canadian side of Lake Ontario than the United States side. And we have a pretty significant stake in the whole thing. The Great Lakes is the largest source of surface water in the world. The basin contains over 21% of the fresh water, surface fresh water of the world. It provides water to over 40 million people, and it contains 84% of the fresh water in North America. This is pretty big numbers. And we have 10 states and 2 Canadian provinces, if you include the St. Lawrence with Quebec, 2 Canadian provinces involved. It's almost a third of the Canadian population that reside in this area, contains 25% of the agricultural power of Canada and 7% of the United States. We never think of that. 25% of agriculture is in the Great Lakes Basin of Canada. Now let's just take a look at the region. If you take Ontario and you take the 10 states, it's a major player in the world. 4.7 trillion dollars worth of output in 2011. If you took this region and you called it a separate country, it would be the fourth largest economy in the world. It'd be bigger than France, bigger than Brazil, and bigger than the United Kingdom. There's been a lot of agreements in the past regarding the Great Lakes, starting right before, well, we didn't have a good agreement back in 1812, but then after that we had some agreements. We had the agreement starting in 1909, the Boundary Waters Act, then agreements on environment and fisheries and sustainable water. One of the things that happens in the Great Lakes is this is this massive amount of water flowing through. Everybody wants to use it. Some people are Canadian, some people are American. We've got to come up with some way to figure it out. Every couple of weeks, the Joint Commission gets together and figure out who gets what water. So they figure out this hydro plant will get this much water, and this like, that much water, and that sort of thing. So it really is quite a complicated area. It's a sharing of resources. There's a lot of agreements and a lot at stake for the cities and for the communities of the area. And out of that came the initiative. The Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Initiative is a binational coalition of over 120 United States and Canadian mayors and local officials working to advance the protection and restoration of the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence. The initiative works with mayors and municipal staff to protect and preserve the Great Lakes, and they do it locally, regionally, state, and binationally. So they reach in a whole bunch of different levels of decision making in the way they work them. The initiative was founded by Mayor Daley of Chicago. He was one of the main pushers in 2003 to get things going, and Mayor David Miller was one of the founding chairs of the initiative. It has, as I said, over 120 active members, and Port Hope is a member of the initiative. It represents over 14 million people in the basin. It's headquartered in Chicago, but it has other offices in Toronto and Montreal, and it is funded through the members and through foundations and stuff like that. So what does it do? Now you can see there's a list down the side of a lot of different things, and you'll hear, and there are certain initiatives you'll know. The Green Cities Initiative is an initiative of the Great Lakes Cities Group. They're dealing with Asian carp. They create statements about things every once in a while that are important for their members and important for the local areas and the local communities to bring forward to the states and to the federal governments in their understanding of what's important for the communities. So they talk about climate change, about nutrients and algae blooms, about nuclear energy, invasive species, oil transportation on the Great Lakes, and a lot of other different issues. And those issues change as the mayors get involved and as the communities see problems on the Great Lakes. Mayors bring these things to the initiative so the initiative can provide the weight of all the cities and all those areas. And the communities within the initiative range from the big guys like Chicago down to townships in Ontario. Examples, this is one example of a project. Last year in Lake Erie there was a massive algae bloom. And this, you can probably remember back to the 70s, the dead Lake Erie and those types of issues, and the big things that happened, taking phosphorus out of detergents and soaps, putting massive amounts of money into sewage treatment plants to bring phosphorus down so that the lakes wouldn't die. So last year there was a massive algae bloom in Lake Erie, and there are algae problems also in Lake Ontario showing up. To deal with this, we're now looking at things like agricultural runoff. Some of the easier stuff, like the soaps and the sewage treatment plants, have been dealt with. So they're now looking inland. And to do this, you really do need to go into the local communities, work with the Ontario Federation of Agricultural and Food, work with the different drainage superintendents of the communities, and develop initiative. And that's through the city's initiative. They're doing that in Lake Erie on the Thames River Basin. So why is it important to have Port Hope involved? It's an opportunity for Port Hope to have a voice on Great Lake matters. And, you know, it's funny, I think in our generations, Port Hope and even the communities along Lake have turned away from the lake to a certain extent. You know, at one time, this was a massive port city, town. This is one of the busiest ports on the Great Lakes. I know my ancestors would go over on a boat over to Rochester, and a bunch of them stayed there when they met some good-looking women. So we have relatives, and I'm sure lots of the old families have relatives on both sides of the lake. The lake was a center point for our communities, and I'm not sure it is in the same way, but it is, because it is the lifeline, it is fresh water, it is what we drink, it is what we recreate with. We need a statement in that. We need a seat at the table for the lower tier municipalities on these large agreements and things like that. Right now, there's a lot of work going on in Lake Erie, but there are issues in Lake Ontario, Gladoffer, and other issues like that are going to come to roost, and this will be important for communities to have statements in. And one of the other things it does that none of the other level governments can do is it brings both sides, the American and the Canadian side, as a joint initiative to the major levels of government. And so that's an important point in the initiative. And I'm hoping that has given you some background. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Any questions of council? Mark, we very much appreciate the overview and the presentation. We get quite a few communications regarding this, and there's no question that from a municipal perspective, you know, it is important to us, and we count on you helping us represent ourselves appropriately. And I see the initiative, you know, these projects online increasing. So again, I think you've done a very comprehensive overview, and I appreciate it very much, and we'll be in touch a little further.
And Mr. Mayor, there is the annual conference is coming up in June, and it's in New York, Niagara Falls, in New York. And it's something that someone might want to consider going to. Thank you.
The papers are on my desk, actually. Can I have a mover and seconder accept this for information, please? Deputy Mayor Burns, seconded by Councillor Andrews. All those in favor? Approved. Thank you. We can move on to the next presentation. Stu Mill, Yacht Club, regarding Port Hope Yacht Club. If you can come forward, please. Thank you.
Sanderson, councillors, staff, my name is Stuart Mill, and with the Port Hope Yacht Club. And slide number one pretty much says it all. What it doesn't say is the person, that one of the people who recommended that we come and speak to you was Michel Bourque. Sadly, he's not with us. A little bit of history from the Port Hope Yacht Club. We are from the other side of the tracks down near the lake. And we started off in 1962, a small group of sailing enthusiasts leased the harbor from the Harbor Commission, and that's how it began. In 1963, they purchased a property with a little white dot at the left in between the viaducts. There is a storage area for cradles. In 1965, only 3 years into business, the Yacht Club members paid for and built the building top right-hand corner of the Terming Basin. Shortly afterwards, the building on the left-hand corner of the Terming Basin, the station house from the Architectural Conservancy of Ontario, was placed there, and we look after that. In 1973, the Yacht Club became incorporated as a not-for-profit corporation. During the intervening years in the 80s, there were various cranes installed for the lifting of masts and motors. A garage was built to hold what was called the scrounge, or a rescue vessel, from the Yacht Club. And there was a tank, holding tank pump out installed in one end of the gallery. 2009, we built a patio shelter as an extension to the clubhouse. 2015, the yacht club had grown to 42 members with 32 boats on moorings, which are provided for and maintained in the turning basin by the yacht club. In 2016, the lease with the municipality expired, and after 53 years, the yacht club was given 90 days to vacate the premises. It's come a long way in 53 years from being what was basically a coal yard. The benefits of the Yacht Club to Port Hope. The Port Hope Yacht Club is self-funding, not-for-profit boating club for sail and the occasional powerboat. Members volunteer their time, efforts, and talents and funds to run the club. The Yacht Club members pay the insurance and taxes and operate the facility and maintain the buildings and equipment and the station house at no cost to the municipality. The club members keep the grounds and the waterfront area mown, maintained, and pay for garbage removal at no cost to the municipality. We don't have municipal garbage pickup. All the utilities, electricity, water, gas, telephones are paid for with membership dues at no cost to the municipality. The members of the club act as ambassadors for the municipality and provide docking and club facilities for their sister yacht club from the American side at Brockport, which is just west of Rochester. We look after the HMSCS Skeena, Sea Cadets, and 66 reciprocal yacht clubs from around the lake, and some of those even go into as far as Quebec. This is titled No Dredging, because that is the premise of our presence here. We realize that sediments from the lake and from the river accumulate in the entrance to the harbor, right in between the concrete breakwaters. The yacht club and the marina both mutually benefit from the dredging that has been done in the entrance. But we realize that the costs have become simply prohibitive. No dredging has been required in the western channel that goes down towards the turning basin or to the inner harbor. There's a little bit of misinformation in the press, I believe, that says that the town is dredging the area where the club is located. That has not been the case. No dredging was ever required in the lease, or provision was made for in the lease agreement that has just expired. And the Port Hope Yacht Club operated for many years with no dredging at all. And most of the boats, at least at the beginning, were shallow draft and didn't really require dredging. There are some financial advantages to having a yacht club. The municipality does not subsidize the club in any way if we exclude the dredging factor. In fact, the yacht club provides revenue to the municipality. We pay $14,000 approximately in lease fees and $3,000 in property taxes for an aggregate of $17,000. The clubhouse costs and services are approximately $14,000, are funded solely by the members. Property insurance, water, hydro, gas, telephone, and waste removal. The club pays approximately $1,300 and countless man hours to maintain the property harbor and the waterfront. The club also affords free promotional advertising to Port Hope. In fact, if you think many of your brochures have pictures of pretty little sailboats that belong to the club. The club financially supports the community and contributes to numerous local businesses, especially the local LCBO and the Brewers Retail. There are going to be some financial disadvantages if the club is not in the harbor. Immediately you'd lose the $17,000 in taxes and lease fees. And assuming we're not there, it would cost the town approximately $8,000 in loss of tax money, the payment of insurance for the buildings and the area, and they would have to look after the waterfront area. Now, I realize that's an approximate figure, so they'd also lose their free advertising, and the local businesses would definitely, the borough's retail would hurt. There's also a negative publicity possibility. There are a lot of folks that are aware of the yacht club. I don't know how many people in the town even know there's a yacht club down there beyond the train tracks. But 66 reciprocal clubs, 3 boating publications, newspapers, radios, TV, and all those train passengers that stop on the viaducts on the way into the Port Hope train station. If we're allowed to stay until the cleanup, the Port Hope area, Port Hope area initiative has stated for a long time that they plan to look after the club if we're forced to move for the cleanup of the harbor, and they've said for a long time that they would help us return to status quo ante. And the club itself would look forward to coming back. We realize we have to go at some point, but our hope is always that we would come back to our harbor, our home port of Port Hope. The last but not least is the delegation request that the Port Hope Yacht Club be allowed to continue to operate the yacht club in Port Hope at no cost to the municipality, with a lease at a fair and reasonable rate. The Port Hope Yacht Club members would assume the risk and liability of being able to get in or out of the harbour. And the PHYC would not request or require dredging. And that is our humble request. And if you have any questions, I'd like to try to answer.
Thank you, Stuart. You did really well. open the question to Council. Councillor Plattner.
Could you tell me how many members you have now?
That's a really loaded question. I think about 12.
Okay, thank you. And could you tell me how many of those 12 are residents of the municipality?
Offhand, I couldn't.
Okay. Now, if we look a couple of years ago, I can't remember which ministry it was, but the actual harbor was not listed as one of the harbors that would be recommended to pull into if you were into distress. So the 66 other reciprocal yacht clubs that we're working with, how many of those actually visit our harbor every year? Did you know?
We get reciprocal requests from many more than 66 clubs. It's difficult to tell exactly.
How many boats physically actually visit here though, in a year?
I would say about 50 from reciprocal yacht clubs.
Okay, thank you.
Deputy Mayor.
The slide that you've got up right there, the second last bullet point, the Port Hope Yacht Club members would assume their own risk and liability for exiting and entering a harbor. I guess my concern as a member of council is that without dredging, what happens with those who are coming in and out from outside? You're indicating that you would assume your own risk and liability, but I'm more concerned about the visitors that come in.
I think it's up to a sailor to pay attention to the rules of navigation, the rules of Canada, and they have to know where they're going, and they stay in contact with the Coast Guard. So it's pretty much their own responsibility, especially if there's a notice to navigation put out that the water in Port Hope Harbor was shallow, the entrance being shallow.
And just a follow-up, if I can, to a question that was asked by Councillor Plutnik, can you supply us in short order the number of people from Port Hope who are members of your club? I'm not suggesting tonight if you don't have it, but it would be helpful for us to gain some sense of how many residents of Port Hope are actually members of the club.
I would think the loss since the lease agreement was terminated or the notice was given, we had 36 members, and we're down to definitely under 16. But I would say of the total, there would be about 10 residents of Port Hope.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Councilor Andrews?
So you're saying that dredging isn't required? Has dredging ever been required?
The dredging was done commercially for a long period of time, but ever since I joined the club in the early 90s, there was no dredging up until the last 5 years when the Port Hope Town took over the harbour, and with the divestiture funds, I understand, made dredging with the Cobo Dredge and Oliver's backup.
And I would ask why?
I understood that when the harbour was divested, that that was part of the agreement, was that the harbour be maintained for 5 years as a minimum. But the yacht club has no attachment to the purse strings, and no decision was ever made by the yacht club to do any dredging.
Well, that's kind of interesting. The terms are up, and we don't have to do any more dredging, and there's no cost going forward. I don't see what the issue is.
Councilor Butcher?
Mr. Mills, if we were to enter into an agreement with the yacht club with so few members, I'm just wondering how you would be able to pay the fees or any fees that we set reasonably. So would it be based on there being only 12 members of the club?
Well, that is indeed a problem. Club is non-profit, it doesn't charge excessive fees, and part of the reason for low fees is that we put up with moorings instead of docks, we put up with no electricity, water, or so on. We spend a lot of money on that clubhouse alone, and yes, indeed, with 12 members, it's going to be a real struggle, but we think we can find a way through it. And part of the problem is that we had bigger boats that have automatically been excluded by the fact that the dredging is not going to occur. But we think we can last for 2 years until the Port Hope Area of Initiative kicks in and throws us out anyway.
Thank
you. Councillor Clayton?
Just so I'm clear on this here, the yacht club and it hasn't done well. It's not particularly beneficial to any group, and it has always been a problem for large draft boats. You're counting on the PHRA to be able to facilitate you at Coburg during the cleanup, and then you'd like to come back? Is that what you mentioned?
Yes, that is the hope.
Okay, but we're still going to be in the problem that we're in. And it is, besides the fact that you're saying there's no other cost, there are other costs associated with it, because we have to personnel and that type of thing. There's the wall casements around the place. There's a lot of work that has to be done just to make sure that it is safe, which isn't necessarily your part. Okay, thank you.
Councilor Lees.
Thank you, Your Worship. The point of not doing dredging is very interesting, but I would like to seek a legal opinion, because in my opinion, it's all fine and dandy to say we won't dredge and they'll take all the responsibility. That'll be great until somebody runs aground, either our own members in the yacht club or people coming and visiting. So I would like to seek, before we sign any legal lease agreement with the yacht club, I'd like to seek legal opinion based on not dredging, because like I said, it sounds great that there'll be no responsibility on a municipality, but you know as well as I do, when somebody runs aground and there's thousands of dollars damage, there could be a suit. So I'd like to seek legal opinion before we sign any agreement with the yacht club. Who's liable and who's going to pay for it? Because I really find it difficult to believe that in the lawsuit that the municipality wouldn't be responsible. So I'd like to seek legal opinion on that one. Thank you.
Any other comments?
May I respond to Councillor Lees?
Yes, you may.
So that is going to be the case whether the yacht club is there or not. We're simply asking to continue a lease without dredging. But if somebody's bound and determined to run into a sandbank, we can't do anything to stop them.
Well, thank you. I'd like to make a couple of comments too. We've had a few conversations, and I appreciate you being here this evening. I think we got to this position, with you, with already having this kind of communication, which it would have been nice to have maybe earlier. And the heritage of the yacht club is an important factor within the community, independent of all the small details. And I just want to summarize the request that you're making, which is basically to have the municipality have no risk and no investment, but that your club continue to be able to operate within the Turney Basin and use your facilities, and that, you know, the ongoing situation would be year by year from, if I have it right from our discussions, right? And that, yes, you're down to 12 to 16 members. I don't know what will happen if, in fact, you know, you are able to sustain yourself through the next year or two as a yacht club. But, you know, I certainly would like to see that happen on a personal basis. So we have two choices from a council perspective, one which is to receive this for information and carry on, and what generally happens there is nothing, quite frankly, or to take it from council and recommend that we reopen this discussion, you know, with staff to validate, as Councillor Lee says, and whatever other concerns the municipality may have, that we don't have it as a dead project. And I think we deserve to, you know, maybe have another look at it. And I propose that, you know, if I get a mover or a seconder, that we ask staff to meet with you and revisit this in the hopes that we can achieve the goal that you put forward.
That would be very much appreciated, sir.
Could I have a mover to that effect, that we ask staff to meet with the yacht club, following up with their request? Councillor Andrews? Seconded by anybody? I will certainly second it. Any further discussion? Okay, what I have before council right now is the request that staff follow up to talk to the yacht club to see whether or not this yacht club can continue using the facilities that they have at no cost to the municipality and at no risk to the municipality. All those in favor? Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, just so I'm clear, if I'm running a 40-foot boat and I'm in troubled waters on Lake Ontario, I would go to the Canadian Coast Guard site to find out what is a safe harbor. We're not listed as a safe harbor, is that correct? For a 40-foot boat, I have a 9-foot draft.
I think you would think twice about trying to come in with a 40-foot.
But I would recommend that I wouldn't come to this one.
I think that's a general knowledge answer.
So we're trying to keep something open that is literally the federal government divested it because they said it wasn't functional or viable any longer. We took it on, spent $283,000 the first year dredging the whole thing. We spent hundreds of thousands of dollars. There are associated costs with it, which are staff and other functions. Now, not all with part, but there's all of that in there. Plus, there is the seawall that's on the one side that is in trouble. There are a lot of costs, and I think this is really something that very few residents of the municipality benefit from compared to other programs that we would be looking at. I'm having trouble pushing this one through.
With respect to some of your comments relative to the wall, that's totally independent of the yacht club. It has nothing to do with them whatsoever. That's in the Turney Basin. Secondly, I think what the yacht club is coming forward with is a request to sustain themselves through a difficult time, and that there is no risk and or cost to municipality. I think, as pointed out in the presentation, there are potential some downsides, and I think at this point in time to just say absolutely we're not talking any further is not in keeping with what I would certainly recommend. I don't know what the outcome would be of further discussions, but at least when two people get to the table, and if we can have resolution and allow the yacht club to exist over a period of time, then I'd like to explore those possibilities. If it's not a possibility, that's what the outcome will be. But at this point in time, they're down to 12 to 16 members. They are requesting that we reconsider the information that we have, and that we have further discussions to see if they can survive. And I personally don't feel it's appropriate that we just say no. So, Councillor Andrews.
Well, it appears to me that when we took over this harbor, we made a really bad deal. And we spent a lot of money on this dredging that, I guess it was mandated. Not the yacht club's fault. We took the deal on and we got stung.
Deputy Mayor?
everybody that the funds that were in place to be able to do the dredging, whether some people feel it's needed or not, the bottom line is those funds are drying up real quickly. When those buildings come down on the center pier and they're gone forever, so is all the funding. So in essence, it's going to be the taxpayers, if we have to dredge the harbor, it'll be the taxpayers paying for that rather than the income we make from those buildings.
Councilor Easton.
Again, we've negotiated, had lots of meetings prior to this. We came back and forth two or three times with proposals, and this council turned down the last proposal. Then, we're picking at it again. And I mean, again, my concern is liability. I don't, you can come up with all, well, we're just going to stay in the harbor, but you're just presenting a passageway here, and I'm sorry, might be low draft, but somebody's going to run aground out there, and we're going to be ultimately responsible. As long as we keep the door open, it's going to be used, and somebody's going to run aground, I'm afraid. And then, like I said, we need legal opinion on this for sure before we negotiate again another agreement. Like, every time we bring it back and forth, we say no, then we do it again. I think it's time we did a suggestion here of what we're really going to do here. We've done, how many times have we met with them back and forth? We met with staff, staff's met with them, so then they come back and talk to you, and we're going to meet again.
Now, to clarify, we did not turn it down. We turned it back to them with some provisions which were not accepted. We actually said they could continue under certain provisions, so we did not turn it down. They did not come back to us and agree to our provisions. Yeah.
So they turned it down. Their last proposal, they turned down.
That's correct.
Okay.
How does this proposal differ from what was presented to them? Is this a better deal than we asked for in our negotiations? Or the same deal?
Well, my opinion?
I'd like some facts.
I don't think so. We certainly, we were looking, we wanted costing for dredging, plus they were, we want the last proposal back, the council back, we wanted cost of dredging, plus their fee on top of it. The one before that was just the cost of dredging. That's what the last negotiations of staff and myself did with them. They were going to pay the $40,000, and we brought that back to council. Council said, no, we want the $40,000 plus the lease agreement money on top of that. We took that back to them. They turned it down. That was the last thing that was
and I absolutely,
with council.
And I absolutely agree with you. I think we need a legal opinion, and I don't think we should just turn this down. I think I would recommend that we defer the decision until we get more the legal opinion and move forward from there.
Okay. Council wish.
Well, that would be a friendly amendment. You'd have to make an amendment if you want to.
I'll withdraw the amendment.
Yeah, and Ruth, you would have to withdraw yours.
I would be willing to accept the friendly amendment.
Right. At this point, it's been so rare, but moved by Councillor Andrews, seconded by Mr. Mayor, that this be referred back to staff for a reappraisal, whether or not the direction includes a legal opinion that can be done through a friendly amendment. But at this point, that's the direction, and that needs to be disposed of.
So we've had enough discussion, unless there's something on you.
I'd like to point out to Councillor Andrews that the going rate in Coburg, I believe, is $60 a foot. We're charging 19. There's a number of reasons these people want to be here. They're small craft now. They were bigger ones. But there are very few people in this municipality that are benefiting from what we are already running as an incredibly tight budget. I think that what I would like to see is that any money that we do expend benefits the most amount of people, not the fewest amount of people.
I understand your comments. I also understand their proposal is that there is no cost to the municipality, and there may be some benefits from a financial basis. I just stand and support the recommendation that we review it. So, all those in favor of sending it back for review? All opposed? Denied.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
At this point, Mr. Mayor, I think there should be a motion to receive the presentation for information.
I have a move to accept this for information. Deputy Mayor Bloom, second by Councilor Hickey. All those in favor? Thank you. Okay, we'll move on to the consent agenda. And we have a fair number, but a lot of them are regarding our strategic plan. So we have 1 through 20. And if there's nothing being pulled out, I won't read them all. I'll ask for a mover. Accept these. Deputy Mayor, seconder. Councilor Fletcher, any discussion? All those in favor? Carried. After this, I'd like to turn it over to Corporate Services, Councilor Kolegnik.
Good evening. Corporate Services is open. I'd like to bring to attention to the public's attention. I found out something tonight that some people are confused. I am the chair of Corporate Services. Underneath Corporate Services is marketing, and underneath that there is communications and community engagement, and now will be the shelter of hope. So if you have questions on any of those issues, you're able to bring those forward. Staff reports, none. Business referred, none. New business. 1.3.1, Cameco Corporation regarding the 2015 fourth quarter compliance monitoring and operating performance report for Port Hope Conservation, conversion facility. Recommend that I receive this for information. May I have a mover, please? Councillor Hickey, seconded by Councillor Lees. Any questions? Seeing none, may I have a vote, please? Carried. Thank you. Question period of council. None. Question period of the media.
None. During or in the consent agenda that you just passed, there's a number of reports regarding the strategic plan. What is the status of the strategic plan?
Actually, that's about to be announced. We had a group meeting today that went through all the final aspects of the draft, and there will be a schedule coming out shortly which will identify the dates, where there will be public hearings, and then when there will be opportunity for the public to comment. I don't want to put that out at this point because we're just finalizing it to make sure everybody's getting it in line, but everything should be done, I believe, by May 17th? May 17th is when we'll be completed. Yeah, it'll be up on Friday. Any other questions of the media? Any questions of the public? Come on, Sandra, I gave you the shot.
I didn't know you were the boss. I got a couple of questions ready.
Mr. Haskell did question me why there was not enough marketing information presented by Mr. Narrowway into the rural area. But right now, there are discussions about two possible cycling races that will be held up there. There will be an opportunity for the rural businesses to be able to join in on co-op advertising programs that we're putting forth. But the other thing that really needs to happen is the rural individuals need to come forth, because if they've got a program or event or something, that's how those things are brought together. So if somebody has something that they want to do, they bring it forward. So Float Your Fanny was brought together, and you know the people that are running it. That's community driven. So if there's something that the rural people would like to talk about, I can tell you Kevin's available at any time. Seeing no questions, Corporate Services is closed.
Finance is open. Staff reports, David Baxter, Director of Finance, regarding tax levy allocation review recommendations. Recommend that committee provide direction on any changes to Schedule A of Bylaw 28-2014 for staff to draft an amending bylaw for council approval on April 19, 2016. Now, the tax allocation working group was mandated by council to review the allocation of common and special services as they apply to the municipality of Port Hope. We wish to thank all those who attended our open house on March 22nd, and especially those who have subsequently submitted their concerns. Given the importance of this review and the interest demonstrated by our citizens, we want to ensure our group has time to thoroughly review these comments, the comments received. Taking into account the short period of time allotted to submit comments, the Tax Allocation Working Group would like to extend the timeline to accept further comments through to the end of April. In early May, the working group will meet again to review all comments received and schedule a public meeting or meetings to address all issues identified. In order to facilitate this process, I would like to move the following recommendation. That there be no changes made to the 2014 Special Services Bylaw at this time, that we continue to receive comments through the month of April, and the working group respond to comments in a public forum, and further, that a resolution be prepared for the Council to extend the tax allocation working group timeline until the Finance Committee makes a recommendation to Council. We have a mover, moved by Councillor Plutnik and Mayor Sanderson. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Business referred, none. New business, none. Questions of Council? Questions of the media? Questions of our audience? Seeing none, finance is now closed.
Under planning this evening, there are no staff reports and no business referred. Under new business, I do have a committee of 3.3.1, the committee of adjustment regarding a notice of application, which is number A01/16, for a property located in concession 2, part lot 21 and 22, which is more particularly described as lot 19, plan 192. This meeting is scheduled for Thursday, April 21st, 2016 at 4:35 p.m. in the Canton Municipal Offices. I want to recommend that we receive this for information purposes at this time. So can I have a mover? Mayor Sanderson, and seconded by Deputy Mayor Burns. Any further discussion? All those in favor? That's carried. I do have two points I would like to make, just public service announcements. Greenwood Coalition is presenting an evening of a possibility called Imaginate. I know a number of people in the community have been attending these events before. They have a new poster out. It's happening Thursday, April 28th at the Capitol Theater, and the tickets are $30. And this is a street level charity that offers community care in the within the municipality of Port Hope, and it's a great event. I've attended it before. It's been done in a TED Talk type of series, so it's if anyone's interested, I will have the poster and we'll put it up in downstairs in the municipality's office. Also this weekend, coming April 9th, Saturday, there are a number of events in the municipality, and if anybody is interested, the Ganaraska Region Conservation Authority is having its annual fundraising dinner. I think tickets are still available, $70 per person, and this helps to support the Forest Center and some other programming initiatives within the Forest, the Ganaraska Region Conservation Authority. And there's also members of the community have contacted me with respect to cleaning up. I know at this time of year we see a lot of cleanup programs happening, and I know Councillor Hickey and I have talked about this before with members of the community. There is a big pitch-in program that's being run in Coburg, and if anyone's interested in forming some groups within Port Hope, I know a few people have contacted us before, but if they'd like to contact us again. And I know for a fact we have a rural group out along Lakeshore Road that tries to get together in the spring and do a cleanup, and I would suggest that other people do that in their neighborhoods as well. And Councillor Weeds will speak to another cleanup matter, so it's great to have some community involvement with cleaning up in the community. And that's it for announcements. So if there's any questions of Council, questions of the media?
Yes, you and Terry attended apparently a presentation at TCS on Friday. Would either of you like to comment on it? Because I've heard some very positive feedback through my connections with TCS.
I'd be happy to comment on that. It was a presentation by the grade 7 class, and they were doing a project with an architectural group on sustainability, and they presented a really great project on cleaning up the foul factory along the Ganaraska River and some other modeling for what kind of activities could happen along there. And the mayor was there as well, and we were very impressed with the group, and we've actually invited them to come to council. And I believe we have a date. Is it April 19th?
You're looking at the
19th. It hasn't been finalized yet, but what we asked was for the students to come and to present their model. It's a fantastic model, and you'll have an opportunity on that evening, and we can follow up. But it was a fantastic community event, and we've recommended that any school projects that have plans for the community, that they could also come forward and do presentations to council. So we'll follow up on that. Any other questions of the public? Seeing none, planning is closed. Thank you.
Parks, Recreation and Culture is open for the evening under staff reports 4.11. Jim McCormick, Director of Parks, Recreation and Culture, and Leslie Roseley, Community Development Program Manager, regarding the Jack Berger Sports Complex Revitalization Project. The final report, we'd recommend that the Jack Berger Sports Complex Revitalization Project final report be received for information purposes, and then further that a letter of thanks from the mayor be forwarded to the volunteers of the Jack Berger Sports Complex Working Group, Fundraising Committee, and the original Revitalization Committee. Can I have a mover and a second, please? Moved by Councillor Palutnik, second by Mr. Mayor. Any discussion? All in favor? Passed. Thank you. 4.12, Jeannie Maiden, Events Coordinator, and W. Nicholson, Traffic Operations Manager, regarding special event temporary road closure for the 7th Annual Battle of the Atlantic Remembrance Parade and Service. We'd also recommend that a resolution be prepared for presentation to Council on April 19, 2016, to authorize the 7th Annual Battle of the Atlantic Remembrance Parade and Service on Sunday, May 1st, 2016, and further that a special event temporary road closure bylaw be prepared for presentation to Council on the 19th of 2016 to accommodate street closures related to this event. Do I have a mover and a seconder, please? Moved by Councillor Andrews, second by Councillor Hickey. Any questions, comments? All in favor? Passed. Thank you. Does any member of council have any new business? Councillor Hickey.
Just wanted to bring some information to everyone's attention. When we were going through the process of discussing the various numbers of motorcycles coming to town for the Highway of Heroes ride, one of the things that happened is that I had an opportunity to talk to a number of people involved in such charities, one of which is Wounded Warriors, located in Whitby. In a meeting with the executive director, just from a timing viewpoint, he was actually trying to get a hold of us as well, because they are in fact planning a bike ride through here on September 24th. So just yesterday morning, in the very warm weather of Quinte West, there was a press announcement with respect to how the ride would be happening, and they would be stopping in Port Hope. And that just coincides with the fact that is the weekend where we'll be having Cultivate. So in fact, that's a marriage of two great things. They're only going to be here for an hour or so as they pass through on their way to Toronto. But I think it's amazing how happenstance and circumstances come together. But this was a really great announcement. I was there, the mayor was there as well, and made some comments. So we're kind of really looking forward to working with Parks and Recreation, because I think this is going to be a really, truly satisfying venture.
Thank you. Just a reminder, this weekend we are having our park cleanup at the new proposed park just south of the fish cleaning station. It's Saturday at 9 a.m. to approximately noon hour. So any members of the public that would like to come out and take part in this new venture of this new park that we're trying to create and clean up in that area, please come forward, and it would be great. Any other members of council have any other new business for Parks and Rec? Seeing none, questions of the press?
I've received some comments recently from the people that have attended the Panthers games, and they're saying that the communication system is very difficult to hear the announcements that are being made. Mm-hmm. Is there any possibility of that being looked at?
Yes, I suppose. Someone made a comment, yeah. We looked at that before, but...
Yeah.
Jim can make a comment about it.
Through the chair, I personally met with the owner of the Portal Panthers last week, and we did discover there was two speakers that were not working in the stands. That's now been rectified. We've had this dialogue with them in the past. It's a balancing act with a number of people. Sometimes there are some challenges, and it also depends on the individual that's actually making the announcements. And proper use of a microphone is crucial with that system. So the system is working as prescribed, as designed.
And what's the status of the car you bought, Oak House, relocation and the related events that are going to coincide with that?
We just had a meeting on that as well.
So, Chair, yeah, we just had a meeting on last night, actually. But there will be a delegation appearing before Committee of the Whole on April the 19th. And at that time, we will be issuing a press release which will outline the planned activities for the relocation of the Oak Roof House.
Any other questions from the press? Questions from the public? Seeing none, Parks and Rec is adjourned for the evening.
And Works and Engineering is open for the evening. This is a hard one. 5.1, staff reports, none. 5.2, business refers, none. 5.3, new business, none. Wow, we're on a roll here. Question period. Any questions from committee? Any questions of the media? And any questions of the audience? Wow, this is good. We're now closed. Police and Fire Services is now open. Staff reports none. Business referred none. New business 6.3.1. Deputy Mayor Burns regarding notice of motion creation of a fire services working group. Now therefore be it resolved that council approve the creation of a fire services working group to examine the following areas and provide recommendations by September 6, 2016. 1. Examine all capital costs of existing stations, including value of property and operating expenses, and costs related to required renovations, upgrades, and potential additions. 2. Review cost savings and impact of a potential two-station model, including determination of proper location, design, and associated construction costs and operating expenses. 3. Complete an assessment of future operational expenses of apparatus, personnel and major expense equipment costs, i.e. air bottle filling station, facility, generator, cleaning and drying machines, with a combined station outcome. 4. Investigate response times for the municipality from all changes to station relocations. 5. Review current water supply operations in place for residents of the municipality and possible future plans for maintaining and upgrading future water supply locations. 6. Review current radio system and the need to move from analog to a digitally operated system to improve communications and solve ongoing current radio and pager coverage issues. And be it further resolved that the Fire Services Working Group shall be comprised of 9 members, including Greg Burns, Deputy Mayor and Chair of Police and Fire Services, Jim Wheeler, Fire Chief, Fire and Emergency Services, Ryan Edgar, Deputy Fire Chief, Fire and Emergency Services, District Fire Chief, Station 1, District Fire Chief, Station 2, Volunteer Firefighter, Station 1, Volunteer Firefighter, Station 2, a citizen of the urban area, a citizen of the rural area, and be it further resolved that the terms of reference be developed for the Fire Services Working Group. I've moved that, and I believe the original motion that Councillor Andrews had signed that. So at this point in time, I'll ask if there's any discussion on this. Councillor Plutner.
I've read through this, and there seems to be somewhat of a slant to a two-station model. Is there going to be a fair review of whether it should be two or three?
That's the reason why it's, I think, if I'll just...
Yeah, point one refers to reviewing costs, but everything else is kind of going the other way.
Basically, what we're looking at is three stations and exactly what the costs are. But without looking at a potential two-station model, I think we would be doing a disservice to the community. So that's been included in that.
There will be a three and a two station.
Absolutely.
Okay. My next question, this is
probably the most extensive fire review this municipality has ever done. Is September 6th enough time?
In talking to the chief and deputy chief, the feeling was that yes, that would be the case. And again, what we're looking at is, as is the case, in, as is normally the case, if in fact we require additional time, we'll come back to council to request that.
Thank you.
Councilor Lee.
I noticed that there's no volunteers from Station 3. Could we have them on there? I really believe that there should be input from Station 3 in this committee. I mean, it just seems to be fair to have, you know, the Garden Hill representation there, I think, should be there. I think we should have a volunteer we should have two volunteers at least, or the chief or something from Station 3. I really think Station 3 should be involved in this.
I think
add two more, two that wouldn't hurt my feelings any.
I'm sure it wouldn't hurt your feelings, though. I think when we reviewed this, we were looking at it, and I may ask the chief to respond to this as well. But one of the things we were trying to do is, originally we were looking at seven members to try and keep it somewhat palatable. Then we decided to add two additional people, so we had citizen involvement. So we're now up to nine. Our comment would be, when we get to 11, we've got a very large group of people. But maybe I could ask our chief to provide a response to that as well.
Through the chair, it was discussed involving personnel from all three stations. The two stations that, if the two-station model was brought to the front, the two stations being involved would be Station 1 and 2. Station 3 in Garden Hill will remain there. However, it will require some upgrades. But certainly, input from Station 3 personnel, they more than likely would feel left out if they were not part of it. I know there was a discussion not to get the group too big, and Deputy Mayor Burns, we discussed that as to whether one or two members would really be a problem. It certainly would bring the whole fire department into it.
I mean, we're, at this stage of the game, we're open. I think that the key thing is that this is going to be a very inclusive look at things, so it'll involve all the firefighters from all the stations. Follow up?
Again, I'd like to add two volunteer firefighters from Station 3, please, if we could. I'd like to amend this to add two from Station 3, please.
Okay, so
two volunteers.
Two volunteers, or the district chief and a volunteer?
Same as the other one.
Okay. Same as from three.
All right. Councilor Plutnik.
The chief has somewhat alluded, and I think this is a very good study and needs to be done, but what he alluded to was that we're kind of looking at a two-station model. I'd really like this to do an all-encompassing, and that you ensure that it is going to, if three is the right answer, and I'm not saying it is, but the previous study that was done went with a predetermined cause of coming up with a two-station. I'd like you to come back and say what it should be. I don't know what it is, but I'd like to see that, and I'm just a little nervous.
Yeah. A personal comment I can make, having been on the council, on the previous council, when that decision was made, my concern was about the two-station model and where it was located and the whole process. This will be an entirely different process. It was very much centralized the last time around. This will be much more inclusive in the sense that every member of the service will be involved and will have an opportunity for input. Whereas before, it was very much a centralized decision.
Especially with the friendly amendment adding you in the other station. Thank you.
Councilor Andrews?
This isn't directly regarding the study, but a quick question of the chief. Rebuilding the Barrett Street Bridge, will that be functional for you if you cross it and try and go north on Cabin Street? Will that give you enough room to swing your trucks around?
I would think so, but we'd have to look at that. The wheelbase on the newer trucks, they do have a shorter wheelbase for that purpose, for turnarounds in crescents and you know, smaller areas. But we'd certainly have to look at that. And of course, the weight range, the availability of weight range of the bridges as well would be crucial because of the weight of the big trucks.
Thank you.
Any further discussions? So we had a friendly amendment to add District Chief, Fire Chief Station 3, and Volunteer Firefighter Station 3. With that friendly amendment, I'll just ask our seconders, you're okay with that? And as the mover, I'm fine with that. Question?
Just a comment. We've had lots of discussions about this, and I think it's a good movement. I think it's appropriate to include Station 3, and I also think it's very appropriate to make sure that the mandate is not predetermined on this. And I think that we'll be very diligent in that process. And I also appreciate putting a timeline on it, but by the same token, if we do the job properly, it needs to be extended. That will be a welcome comment.
I think one, just for everyone's information, one of the reasons why we looked at September originally, when this motion was going to be brought forward, it was June, but it was put off for a bit. What we're trying to do, obviously, is bring something forward that will have some impact on our decisions relative to the 2017 capital budget and operational budget as well. So the intent was to try and bring it in as early as we could so that we could have that dialogue. So with that friendly amendment, all those in favor? Carried. Move down here. Under other new business, and I'm really glad that Councillor Politnik made his earlier observations during his time period relative to rural people, making sure that you heard their particular concerns and also what's happening out there. I have two announcements I'd like to make. This Wednesday night, meaning tomorrow evening, there is a pancake supper at the New Hope United Church in Welcome tomorrow evening, so everybody is welcome to attend that, and that's basically raising funds for the operation of the church. And then secondly, St. Paul's Anglican Church in Perrytown on County Road 10 presents their annual Easter Cantata this Sunday, April the 10th, and it starts at 10 a.m., their service time. So 10 a.m. this Sunday is the annual Easter Cantata at the St. Paul's Anglican Church in Perrytown, and luncheon will follow. That being said, any questions of council? Questions from the media?
In the library minutes, there was some mention of the move of the Garden Hill Library being moved from its current location.
All it was basically a discussion of a possibility, depending upon what happens with station number 3. If you look at, and again, this is part of the reason why we're doing this study, because right now, if we were to do the modifications to station number 3 that are required, it brings us very close to the property line next to the Wilson Farm, but it also would involve us having to remove some of the stuff at the back end, like the former tennis court there. Whereas if in fact there was a move, let's say, of the library, Garden Hill Library, to the Kent Municipal Office, then all that area that is currently used by the library could be in fact used for offices, change rooms, showers, etc., that we don't have there. Any other questions of media? Questions of the public? Seeing none, Police and Fire Services is closed for the evening.
I would just like to remind again that the County Council meeting and Dr. Stan Fletcher's delegation to County, it's important that if we can get support to that, I would like to encourage that. I will announce it again at the next Council meeting as well. And thank you everybody for their participation, councillors, media, and the public. It's been a good meeting, and with that, I will adjourn. Have a good evening. Thank you.